Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of The Richard Lewis Show. I am, of course, Richard Lewis, and it's one of those episodes where we have a guest, and it's someone that I've known for a long time, 8 years or so, a chap that is recently retired, which I'm sad about. Not everyone is. It is, of course, Spunj, formerly of Renegades, Vox Eminor, and God knows how many other fucking Australian teams, Sydney Underground as well, of course. So look, I guess that's where we start then, man. How's retirement treating you? I know it's not a decision that you took lightly.
No, it's been a pretty quick week of retirement, really. It's gone pretty fast. But I actually am really happy in the sense of I feel like a massive weight has been lifted off my shoulders. Probably a lot, like put it on myself kind of thing, but I'm feeling pretty happy now that I've actually quit. It wasn't something I took lightly, and it wasn't a decision which, you know, was very easy for me. But I'm happy to have retired. And, you know, I'm excited about the future, really.
I mean, there'll be some people out there who'll say it was a long time coming. And obviously, I remember just after that major qualifier, we went out and had a few beers over in Columbus. And, you know, you were pretty fucking upset, man. You were pretty inconsolable. I kind of think that's where you made up your mind to quit. That was when you thought, this is enough for me.
I think was it? As soon as I started going down that path of thinking like that, and that was pretty dark, like the way that I was thinking there was pretty dark. Like as soon as I started going down that path, it was probably time for me to hang it up. I'd spoken to Gomez numerous times about it, like not in a sense of like, hey, I feel like quitting or like this is something which is on my mind, like what should I do? It was the sense of when I get to a point that I think I should quit, where do we both feel that is? Because like it was kind of me and him driving the team ever since like Vox Eminor days with Talnoy. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like the three of us together, and then we branched off to the Renegades thing. Talnoy stepped back and he just went, you know, he left the gaming world from there. And it was just me and him. So he would tell me that when I didn't feel that I could contribute anymore was when I should hang it up. And that's kind of the way I felt in the sense of playing. I probably could have contributed more and like being there for the guys and offering advice. And I didn't want to do the coaching thing. I spoke to you about the coaching thing. Yeah. Like after that.
Why not?
I don't want to coach that bunch of players because like, I was the in-game leader of that core group or the mentality of that core group for such a long period of time that I can't offer anything new to them from an in-game leader perspective. Sure, as a coach, like I can step back and I can do it without worrying about, you know, having a frag as well. Yeah. But I can't bring a new perspective. Somebody else has to bring a new perspective to those players to like take them potentially to that next level. Right. So I felt that for them, I couldn't be a coach. And the more I've thought about it, it's probably the right thing for everybody involved.
Mm. So you said it was pretty dark. I mean, how dark? I know. When we started drinking beers, you were ready to get on a fucking plane, just peace out and go back to Australia without even saying goodbye to anybody.
Yeah, like I didn't want to do it anymore. Like the basically from that point when we started having beer, like I was sitting at the bar alone. Like that's pretty bad. Like that was a bad loss. Mm. Like it's one of those ones where as a team, there's nothing you can say to each other because the loss was like, it was close matches. It wasn't like we had lost and, you know, it was like another one of our 16-0s kind of thing. You know, when that happens, it's just like, okay, well, there's nothing we could have done. When it's a close match, you sit there and you question literally every decision you made. And I couldn't sit in the room I was rooming with Ustilo at the time, and I couldn't sit there in the room and just like, because of how bad I felt I played and how much I let the team down, I couldn't just sit there. So I just had to go to the bar. I was having some beers. A couple of people came and offered some words, and then you rocked up. And I think by that point, like I was just ready just to honestly just jump on the phone, book a flight, and just get out of there. I didn't want to go back to the hotel. I didn't want to go back to Vegas. I didn't want to see him. Like I was ashamed, and I felt that I'd let not only like the team down, but like, we kind of have the weight of Australia on our shoulders and probably will do for some, like that body of players will do for some time. And that's pretty like, it's a pretty big deal. I don't know. I don't know how dark we can get into it, but yeah, a lot of self-loathing.
You can speak your mind. I mean, I've been pretty open about my dark periods as well. So yeah, I you know, can completely fucking empathize. It's strange, you know, we put ourselves in these positions where it's like, you're right, I think we end up shouldering stuff that's kind of like bigger than ourselves, probably take a bit too much on, you know, like with me, it's obviously being like sort of the fucking, the watcher on the wall, right? Making sure no one's getting fucked over in esports, and you've got the whole weight of Australia on your back and a bunch of other stuff. Like, I know you almost felt kind of, you know, like a responsibility to these sort of younger players as well, you know, like, because you're the old veteran now, whether you like it or not.
Yeah, I think, like, I felt responsible. Like, this is a thing. There's lots of stuff that I put on myself throughout the last 12 months that I shouldn't have, actually probably over the last couple of years. And they're like responsibilities which I didn't necessarily need to take. But as kind of, you know, one of the older guys in the team, and one of the people who have been around this industry for the longest period of time, especially like, you know, CGS and getting fucked over by all that kind of stuff, I kind of felt a responsibility to push these guys in the direction that I felt was best. And then to let them down on the scoreboard and in the server, it's like, well, I want what's best for them, but I'm fucking them over at the same time. Yeah. And like the Renegades thing as well was kind of not my choice, I guess, like, because we had an offer from Liquid at the same time as the Renegades thing was happening. And I was like, well, I want to go with the Renegades because it's something new. And I thought that it would be something great for the guys. And then when it's not that it ended up like horribly, you know, we still were pro players for 12 months. So that was all right. It just wasn't what I was expecting. And then I felt that was my fault for kind of pushing them in that direction. Yeah, not playing fantastically. Obviously, there was, you know, being away from home for such a long period of time. I know, like, people are like, oh, well, you know, Luminosity and all those kind of guys, they do it, but they kind of have a bit of a different support network set up around them, you know. And there was just so many different things that I was just worried about, as opposed to just getting in the server, being an in-game leader, focusing on it, and it was just so draining. I'm trying to make the classic excuses that
I don't think anyone would take it as excuses. I mean, I made this point, and you know me, like, obviously I hear a lot, and I talk to guys, and when I talk to players, I want them to realize that I'm just there as just a guy, like just a friend, you know, like it's not about journalism, it's not about publishing everything that I hear. Probably keep 99 secrets for everyone that gets out, right? But you know, I think it's like hugely unfair on you guys, actually, that people weren't aware of some of the stuff that was going on with Renegades, because I know firsthand, and we can probably talk about it now because we're not under contract anymore. You know, you wanted a coach, right? Like, you wanted somebody to coach the team. You wanted people to come in and help you out and lighten some of the burden, but that assistance never came.
Yeah, I think I've had a lot of time to think about that kind of stuff. And with the organization, it was, if people don't really know the story of Renegades, basically it was a League of Legends team called Misfits, and then Monte Cristo got involved with a guy called Chris Badawi, and then they turned it into Renegades, and then Renegades had some kind of relationship because of Monte Cristo with WME IMG, and then they said, hey, do you want to be our Counter-Strike team? I said, yeah, that sounds sick. So we became the Renegades Counter-Strike team, and then that's kind of where it all started. And the basis that I got sold on was the fact that it was something new and there was something that was going to be player orientated, which was sounded fantastic. You know, you want an organization that looks out for the players and stuff. So that was something that I was really into. And I think it was just, I don't know, maybe they expected us to do more for ourselves than we did. Maybe I was expecting them to do more for us than they actually did. But it just was, there was a communication breakdown. And they said to us, this is a thing actually that annoyed me. They said to me from the early days that they thought for the longevity of the organization that eventually they'd like to see me go into a coaching role for the team, which is fine. And I completely can understand where they're coming from. You know, I think I'm a good talker. You know, an in-game leader would make a good coach, all that kind of stuff. But to kind of get that, not from the get-go when you join the organization, but pretty early on, it kind of like undermines you as a player. And you kind of like feel that they already want you to move into that role, like, straight away. It's like, well, no, the team wants me to keep playing. I want to keep playing. Like, let's get behind that. And they wanted to get us a coach, and we wanted a coach, but the communication breakdown, like, it just never happened. Like, we're probably at fault in some regard. Like, we would offer up people, and then, like, they'd say they'd talk to them, and then, you know, we wouldn't hear back. And then we just get a bit disenchanted by that, you know? Like, it was like, okay, well, if they're not going to follow through, which, like I said, it's just a communication breakdown, I guess, then we just stopped offering up names. We did, you know, try to talk to people like Pronax and God B when he was kicked from Mouse. There was other people who we were considering. Like, we threw around the names like Dazed and Steel, but obviously they couldn't do any coaching because of their bands. And it just never happened. And obviously there's two sides to every story. I don't know. They obviously think, well, this is what I think happened. I think Renegades think that we didn't push it hard enough for it to happen. And I think they didn't offer enough assistance to make it happen. So yeah. I don't know. I don't know where it actually fell.
I guess I could offer an independent perspective, and it would be, I think that Renegades were looking to just save money and cut corners, honestly. And I don't think they wanted to give you a support network that was in line with what other teams had at the time, because like, right, when CS started to grow, right, like you were a fucking bargain. Like, even if you were the worst professional team out there, you would have been a bargain because you came on board. I know your salaries were very modest, and you had no prior attachments because Vox M&O was like a friendly organization that you guys had worked on together. So to get into the space, it was like it was just a no-brainer. You know, that's why other organizations like Liquid and stuff were going to pick you up. Now, what happened in the 12 months you were with Renegades was we saw this unprecedented growth in, like, salary, viewing numbers, prize money for Counter-Strike. And all of a sudden, because of that, there were teams out there that were monetizing appropriately. They could afford coaches, analysts, managers. They could afford all of these things. Renegades didn't monetize appropriately. They didn't have any sponsorship deal beyond Alpha Draft. And I don't even know how active they were looking, or certainly with what competence they were looking, but they never materialized. So I think what it was simply a kind of corner cutting measure to not have a coach. I think it just wasn't factored into their bottom line, honestly. I don't know if that's the impression you got, but I think it, like, for some organizations, it's great to have a Counter-Strike team. Not so great to have a Counter-Strike team and all the trappings that come with it. Suddenly you've got to employ an extra three people, you know, and people just think, well, fuck this. This is actually way more expensive than we'd hoped for.
Well, I know it seemed to me that there was a money flow issue in the sense that, like, I'm not trying to, you know, badmouth anybody or throw anybody under a bus or whatever, but we never actually got paid on time once over a 12-month period. Now, like, if coming from the real world where you'd work a job and if you didn't get paid on time or if somebody didn't pay you for the work you do, like in my work, when I used to do being a plumber, like some plumbers would go back and they would rip their work out of the wall if they didn't get paid. Like, and for the periods of time that we're talking here, like I think the longest period of time that we didn't get paid for was like 2 months. And like, we always got paid, right? We always got paid. The money always came. But why have... Or what's the point of the added stress on the guys going? Because, like Justin, JKS, for example, sure, we weren't at home for like 8-9 months out of the last year, right? Mm. He's still paying rent. He needs the money coming in to pay rent at home, you know?
Yeah.
And I was paying off like a car. Well, I'm still am paying off a car. Money's coming out of my account every week. Like, without the flow coming in, I've got no way to sustain those payments. And I'm not even at home to, you know, answer calls or do anything about it to kind of change that. And so it's just added stress that I kind of took really badly. I wasn't one of the guys who could just sit back and relax about it and just go, oh, well, you know, we've always got paid. I was like, well, why aren't we paid? Like, when's the money coming? Is it coming? And that was really frustrating to me.
As it should be. And I think there's a perverse juxtaposition of you're out there, you know, doing these Alpha Draft adverts where you're like making it fucking rain, right? And you're not getting paid on time. Like, that's fucking bullshit. You know, it's bullshit plain and simple.
It wasn't great. But I think like, to be fair to the organization, like we did always get paid on time or not on time. We always did get paid. Just whether or not it was in the end. So we got the money. I just think, like, for me, it was a thing that if you're going to start something, because this is from the ground up, then you want to, and especially if you're going to be player orientated, those are like the basics. Like, those are the things which you'd want to cover like straight away. It's just, I don't know, just a bit disappointing to me, I guess.
Yeah, and you know, I'll talk a little bit more about this kind of setup in Renegades. Obviously, if there's anything you don't want to talk about, just tell me to shut the fuck up, and we won't talk about it. But you know, you were obviously based out in Vegas, and I know one of the things you really liked the idea of was finally having your group of Australian players and yourself come to America, get into a team house, get into a structured environment, and have that opportunity to work and develop your skills. Well, you weren't really in a team house; you were in a hotel. And you were in a hotel attached to a casino. Is that correct?
Yeah, so we were in the downtown Grand, which is near Fremont Street. Anybody who's ever been to downtown Vegas and been Fremont Street knows it's a pretty lively, loud part of town. The casino itself, like putting us up and doing all of that, as far as I'm aware, that was all part of like a sponsorship deal. So we got literally everything for free. Like when I say we, I mean the organization got everything for free, like our rooms. They bought all of our PCs and stuff, you know, they hooked up like us with the suite room and internet and all that kind of stuff. We got a food allowance. It was all fantastic. But when you're in a space, I don't know if people have, like some people have been to Vegas, obviously. It's not a place where you can live for a long period of time. I talk to Americans and they're like, you know, you go for a weekend and that's it. You know, it's not something where you actually want to be stuck in for a long period of time. That's why I'm assuming not many people live in Vegas, you know? And being stuck in a hotel would probably be a lot different to being in the suburbs in Vegas, but being in a hotel where you practice, like where you work, where you sleep, where you eat, you don't have to leave. And it's hard to leave because what are you going to do? Like, we're not there to gamble. We're not there to go out and get drunk every night. We're not there to party. We're there to work. And sure, you go, okay, well, then you can just sit on the computer and you can, that's your work, right? But everybody needs a release. Like, you need to be able to leave what you're doing and actually see the outside world, talk to other people other than the five guys in your team and the manager. Or you need to be able to do stuff. And it was just so draining. Like, you fall into a cycle. Like, I remember when I was a 17, 18-year-old kid, right? And I could sit on the computer for like 14 to 16 hours a day and then, you know, just eat like 2-minute noodles and go to bed and wake up at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and do it all again. I was like 26 when all this was happening and I had like lived a life. Like the quality of life in Australia is pretty high. Like we have like beaches really close, lovely weather all the time, you know, amazing food. That's another thing. The food was fucking terrible. Like, it just was so draining on all aspects. And if we were maybe in a house in Vegas, in the suburbs, it might have been different, you know? But we didn't have...
Almost like, certainly. Get a cook for yourself.
We didn't have any freedom.
Yeah.
Exactly. You don't realize, like, people are like, oh, it'd be great living in a hotel. You'd never have to cook for yourself, you know? You don't have to do dishes. That's fucking shit. You can't even have breakfast. What do you have for breakfast? Like, you know, I just want a bowl of cereal some days. You couldn't even do that. It was just a completely bizarre lifestyle. Like, and it was, we probably did it for almost 5 months, right? And I don't even know what the casino was getting out of it. That's another thing which bothered me. Like, I don't know why I care about that. I really shouldn't. Like, I was just like, sick, this is great, you know, you get to do all this stuff. But I cared that, like, what exposure was the casino getting out of us? Like, we did those ads and stuff. We walked around, we made it look like, you know, we were there to party and all that. So, but what else was the casino getting was another worry to me. Like, I felt bad for the people that we had to liaise with at the casino. Like, we're basically taking all of this stuff that you're throwing at us. Great, thumbs up. But we're not really giving a lot back. There's not a lot we could do. Mm. So I had that worry on my mind as well. But yeah, the setup in the casino, as much as it was like cool for the first week, the novelty of Vegas wore off pretty damn quick.
Yeah, it has a tendency to do that. What was it like in terms of the ability to practice? Like, was the setup good at least? Like, did you have a big conference room or some shit? Like, how did that work?
So the way it started was we were in a conference. This is the problem because I don't know what relationship that we actually had, like, contract wise. So I don't know how long they expected us to actually be there for, because we're meant to be there like in the lead up for E-League, right? And E-League was meant to start back in like late Jan, early Feb, but it got pushed. So I think they were only expecting us to be there for like maybe a month in the lead up for that, and then get the TV exposure for all that kind of shit, and then, you know, just we could fuck off and go wherever we had to go. So it started off, we were like in the top floor of the casino. We all had these massive rooms, awesome view. It was sick. And then we had for practice, we had Yeah, big conference room. But the problem with the conference room was it was on the casino floor. So like on Friday and Saturday nights when drunk people are wandering around and stuff, the only thing separating them and us was a lock, was a door which you could only lock from the outside. And once we're in the room, well, we couldn't lock it. So people like would wander in from time to time, pop their head in, and it was just a we never really had like full privacy and stuff. The room was like really big, and you know, they set us up a big projector screen, we could watch demos and that kind of stuff. The facility was good in that regard. But, you know, in Vegas you can smoke in the casinos, and like there's just a door separating us from secondhand smoke 24 hours a day. There's music blaring from the casino floor. Like it's not like it's not a facility where, you know, you have much peace and quiet, or you can really focus on what you need to do. And we kind of just, you know, we practiced. It was better practice. Like being in a room together with your team, like you said, it's a better way to do it. It's probably for short stints of time. I think like the Europeans have got it down the best. You know, you go, you practice at a boot camp, and then you go back home and you actually get to see your family, friends, loved ones. You know, you actually get a chance to be a human being, not just a Korean gaming robot.
Yeah. I mean, I fucking hate team houses. I was working on writing a piece at the moment, but I've just been too busy with the broadcast and the show to really finish it off. So I'll probably just make a video. But I think they're just absolute misery factories, dude. Like, I'm not going to fucking lie. Like, I mean, I went to a lot of them in America, and I didn't come across anybody who was happy. I mean, the Renegades League of Legends house especially just put me massively on tilt, just seeing how those guys were living. I mean, I'm pretty sure there was maybe a period of time when you were or being in the CS team, you were thinking, fuck, I'd love to get in the Renegades League of Legends house. I'll tell you.
You did have that thought.
Yeah, you dodged many a fucking bullet there. But, you know, like, I've just never seen, like, consistently just like such a terrible way to just fucking live. Like I had better living conditions when I was a first year student in halls of residence than the average team house. Everything is just designed, again, it's about cutting corners. It's not what it's about. It's not about what's optimal. And I think as well, like this emphasis that they put on, like, always got to be practicing. We're in a team house, so let's like practice for like 10 hours a day. It's just so fucking unreasonable. You know, I've read a lot of sports science studies that talk about how like after like 4 hours, for example, nothing else is really going in. You know, it's like, it's a waste. You've got to have a very specific type of mindset and personality to be able to keep getting good at something the more and more, you know, beyond a certain point. Some people can do it. You know, you'll hear about, like, I know guys like Johnny Wilkinson in rugby, who they used to spend all day, every day, kicking for 12 hours, and it obviously fucking paid off. But then you'll hear about, like, chess grandmasters who literally play for 4 hours a day maximum, and they can beat everybody consistently. So it's different for everybody. And we have this one approach in team houses, and it's like just the chuck enough shit at a wall and some will stick approach to training. And I fucking hate it. I honestly feel so sorry for players that have to live in those environments. And worse for you, right? Because you're in a fucking hotel to boot.
Yeah, it wasn't great. We eventually got moved after that, like, conference room that I was talking about. We got moved into like an old hotel room that basically had no furniture in it. So it was like a downgrade. It was a much smaller room and stuff. But like the casino, they were pretty good to us. Like we had a lady there called Angela, was who we liaised with. She was always looking out for us. You know, if we ever needed anything, they were there for us. But that was a relationship, like, obviously, that we became responsible for. And they put us. We were sharing rooms for a while. We were sharing rooms for quite a while. And I don't know.
So how many to a room?
It was just two? Like two per room. But like, at some point, when you need some privacy, like, I'm not saying you need your gentlemanly time or anything like that, you know. Just
yeah, but you definitely do. You definitely do.
But yeah. You want to be able to.
No, listen, mate. I've talked about this before. One of the reasons sometimes relationships can get fractured if you spend a lot of time hanging out, and it's like, right, okay, I haven't jerked off in 3 fucking days. I haven't had a minute to myself. I'm starting to get a bit testy. And people don't talk about it, but it's fucking true. Absolutely.
Well, some people have pregame rituals where that's required as well. So
yeah, I played a lot of sports with a lot of rugby boys who used to crack one off before they went on the pitch.
But no, I that became a bit of an issue, and we eventually worked that back out. You know, they kind of understood when we explained that, you know, you can only see so much of your teammates. So they gave us our own rooms again. But no, the casino was great to us in the sense of like they looked after us, but it was just such a miserable thing to do for such a long period of time.
Yeah.
So that, you know, added into the depression, I suppose. Like that's what it became for me eventually. Like I was hating Counter-Strike. That's a big reason why, like I was just unhappy. That's also why I just had to give it up, because you can't wake up every day and just hate something. That's just horrible.
So what specifically changed to make you hate it? Like, and how conscious were you aware of how much you disliked it while you were playing? Like, was it there like all the time? Like, I mean, like, this is a fucking chore. I fucking hate this. I hate my life. I can't do this anymore. Like, while you were trying to play?
I think there's like so many factors as to why I started to loathe Counter-Strike and like playing it the way we were. And I've like this last week, like has been like a huge week of kind of reflection on that. And it's kind of opened my eyes to a lot of things, which at the time I never considered or never even, you know, thought were an issue. I had a lot of people message me, when I was streaming, like when I was streaming from Vegas, right? And they were people who used to watch my stream when I was back in Australia and I was getting home from work and then I was jumping on the PC, you know, and then streaming for fun because I liked it. And they were like, first of all, you look tired, you look pale and you look sick. They were the things they were saying. And then they were saying, you just look like, you know, you hate it. Like you're just doing it because you have to. And sure, you know, we had to stream. It was in our contract, but it was never like enforced. And I was streaming because like streaming is really good for a person's brand. But when I was streaming, it was just depressing because like I wasn't enjoying playing. I wasn't enjoying where I was, you know, and that was a telling sign, and that wasn't something I considered at the time. That's kind of something which I, looking back, if I'd realized that then, I would have done things to change that. A lot of these things I could have changed myself, or I could have changed elements of how we were going to kind of make myself happier, because nobody should be responsible for someone else's happiness kind of thing. That's the way I look at it. So there's lots of things I could have done, but I didn't because I was in this rut. So that's one of the things. I hated, obviously, well, I didn't hate. I didn't mind being away from home all the time. Obviously, it's pretty grating. Like, I have a significant other who's now just left me for 6 weeks. But, like, telling my family and my girlfriend that I don't know when I'll be home or I don't know when I'm leaving or, you know, that's really hard because how do they react to that? Oh, do we just leave your bedroom the way it is? Or, you know, oh, am I just going to put my life on hold because you have an undisclosed amount of time that you're going to be away for? And that the relationships there became pretty hard. So that kind of, that was an outside influence, but it also impacted why I didn't like Counter-Strike because it was bringing negative things into my life. And then the passion, this is one that I noticed. And this is about like people, if you remember Vox Seminar days, I used to get up and yell like an idiot. But that was the thing. Like, and when I was playing good was when I was yelling, which is kind of like a factor. Like I always go back to this because this is probably the best professional match at the highest level I ever played was versus Titan on Mirage, Cologne last year.
Yeah.
Like I played really well in that game, and I was getting up and I was yelling like an idiot and I was having a great time with it, and I lost that. Like, I think it was Yam said to me after Gfinity, he said, if we want to be good on a consistent level, you can't do that every match. Because if we're playing like two best of threes in a day, or if we're playing like three really important matches in a day, you, first of all, you're probably going to faint because you're just being an idiot. You're yelling so much. Yeah. I'm paraphrasing here. Basically, the point he was trying to make was that I couldn't get up and just consistently yell because it's not sustainable. Like, it's not a sustainable type of Counter-Strike. I took that on board and I kind of moved away from that. And at the same time, I think that kind of killed my passion, because when I played, like, I loved that. That was like the best side of it, you know, getting fully immersed in it. And from an in-game leader perspective, that's probably not a great thing to have. You need to stay pretty level-headed and you need to be able to look at things from a level-headed perspective.
Ever think about not being an in-game leader?
There was several times where it got to the point where, like, I said to the guys, like you guys call, like someone else call. And we tried it, like, when we had Luke in the team, we tried it for like, I think we tried it for a couple of days and people didn't like it. So we went back. I think there was a period towards the end in the last couple of months where we had like some breakdown and it was like Yam was going to call, but that didn't happen either. And then there were certain times where I felt like when people spoke about it and it felt like they were questioning whether or not like I should be calling. Like I was like, well, if you don't want me to call, then there's really no point in me playing, kind of thing. And that wasn't like, I wasn't like giving them an ultimatum. It was like, if I'm not going to be the in-game leader, which is the main thing I bring to the team, then what's the point in having me? You know, like you can get someone else who's going to frag better. So I did go through my mind, but I think it's being like a leader is, or being somebody who's in control is probably more. So it's something which has been built into me for a long time. I like to be in control. And I think when I was the most in control, that's when I was calling confidently and I was then playing well. So that was a thought, but it never came to fruition. So
when did you kind of remodel yourself as an in-game leader? Because obviously I remember little Chad, who was a very quiet, unassuming chap on the server. Used to be a very hype player. Like you would get fired up. I remember you played under a few Australian in-game leaders. So I remember there was Tegs, obviously. You played alongside him. Was he in IGL for you once or twice? I know Boomza as well.
Yeah, it was Boomza was the main one. Before that, like in the Source days, it was... the way that my career worked was pretty weird. Like as a kid, I just played in like a LAN center, and then I made friends with a bunch of guys there because I don't know, my parents didn't want to buy me a computer or couldn't afford to, one of the two. And then, you know, that's where I started. And then when I started as like a 14-year-old, none of the other guys wanted to do that job. So I did it as like a kid. So when I just played like in local Perth lands and stuff, I was the main one, but I had like influences from other guys like within my scene. Then when I went to Source, which was like later down the track, I was kind of new to Source and I let they were just local people who were in-game leaders for me. There was nobody really like, it was Boomza was the main one. Like that people would know who I played under. So when, you know, CGS died, I think a lot of people stopped playing, like Boomza. I don't remember what Boomza and Tegs were doing exactly. I think they took a break.
They were in Archaic. They got that sponsorship and did Archaic for a bit. Do you remember where they came over 2011? Was it the Copenhagen Games?
Yeah, I'm just trying to, because it seems like such a long time ago now.
Because Luke was in that. Havoc was in that one.
Yeah,
too.
And they had Zershan playing for
them. Yeah, Zershan from Fnatic. Yeah, Milan was playing for them. So that was, I was reading some of the pieces when I was researching, getting ready for this interview, and I found that old lineup because I wanted to check if you were in it. Because obviously we've been drunk so many fucking times. Like, it's like you're always there, like the fucking, you know, like just like Obi-Wan at the end of fucking Star Wars. You're just like this faint fucking outline wherever I'm drinking. So.
No, I think, Boomza was my main in-game leader influence. But like when CGS died, like I kind of went back to 1.6 and then that wasn't happening. So then I went back to Source and made like an immunity lineup with Luke. So it was me and Luke, and then we had Sniper. And then, you know, then I was playing with a couple of other guys and it kind of transitioned a few times over the years. And then obviously Go came out. And when Go came out, it was me, Avic, Sniper. And then I think we had like Moe CQ, who he played for Immunity recently, and a guy called Sultan. What a name. And then there was a Vox Eminal team with like Boomza, Azza currently Top Gun, who else did they have? They had like, I think it was maybe APOC. I'm not sure. Anyway, but when that happened, like a lot of people weren't sure if they were going to play Go. So it was like me, Sniper, Luke. We said, well, we want to play Go. And then We wanted Azza in our team. Like we're like, he's a gun. Like he's going to be the next big thing. Well, he already was. Like in Australia, he was sick. And we wanted him. And he kind of came as a package deal with Top Gun, which, you know, is a pretty good package deal to get. Because like, I love Azza. Like,
Top Gun's a fucking legend, man.
Yeah, so that's kind of where the Vox Eminel thing started for us. It's like late 2012 or something like that. And then I think it wasn't like a power struggle. I don't know. I don't know who was calling back then. I think it might have been Sniper instead of me. And then we transitioned into me in-game leading, and then that's just kind of how it went, like in Go. It was just from the beginning.
Well, that's interesting because I see Sniper on Twitter, and again, like I like the dude. Obviously, don't know him as well as you, but he seems a likable chap. But he's been very fucking critical of you, man. Like, do you think there's any bad blood there?
Oh, there probably is a little bit. There was something that happened on Twitter like a while ago where What was it? I was when Thorin was making, it was a story or a tweet or something that Thorin made, and it like Thorin had been talking to people from the community, and it was something to do with me, and or something to do with our team, and I took like because obviously I wear my heart on my sleeve kind of thing, and I have a lot of pride in where we've come from and my teammates and whatever was said. I can't even remember. I have the worst memory. I swear to God. And it offended me like deeply, and I just went, well, like I can be a real cunt to this guy, and I'll just fuck him on Twitter, and I did. And like I have like I suppose like a following of people who just jump on board with what I say, like everybody does, right? And I was just a dick, and I should bring it up, but I can't be fucked.
Sorry.
I said, it wasn't fantastic, and that probably caused some bad blood. Like obviously, when we removed Ian from the team, that wasn't a fun thing to do because like me and Ian were from Perth, we're the Perth boys, right? And then the rest of them from the East Coast. You know, fuck the guys on the East Coast.
Yeah, fuck the East Coast. Yeah.
So like me and Ian were good mates, and then he had said to us a couple of times like, oh look, I know I'm underperforming. I understand if you have to replace me, this and the other. It's still a really hard thing to do, and I think when we did replace him, he still wasn't expecting it to happen, even though like he had said those things. So I think like initially there was some bad blood there when we removed him from the team, and then we kind of like, not like we mended the fence, but I think time, you know, he saw it for what it was, and you know, me and him were cool. And then I did that stuff on Twitter, and then I don't know if we're cool anymore, but I don't, Ian's a guy that he's like me, you know, he won't hold a grudge forever kind of thing. So there's probably a little bit of bad blood, but you know, nothing too bad.
Should sort it out like proper Aussies and go for a fucking beer and have a punch up if necessary and get it all ironed out.
I don't
want
to fight Ian. He's like did like jujitsu or some shit. So I don't want to go anywhere near that.
You might have to lose one, mate. You might have to take one for the team. Take one for the greater good. Yeah,
just not in the face, right?
Yeah. You're too pretty for that. But so talking about kicking people, this, I know there was one that must have been real fucking tough, and obviously that's Luke Havoc. You played with him all that time, you know. He was going through a very bad patch in Renegades. And everybody in the community was like, they got to kick him. They got to get rid of him. He's just so below the standard of all of his teammates. And, it, you know, to be honest, it was a pretty rough patch for him. And I know, like, because you're a good guy and a loyal guy, you, like, stood by him. I know how difficult it was to kick him. But just talk us through that decision and having to actually do it. Like, did he know it was coming? Like,
so, like, in the history of the team, there's only been, like, four roster changes, right? So, like, Sniper was the first one. Then Top Gun we got rid of because we wanted to take the game more serious and he couldn't put in the time.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, Luke. And the Luke one was so hard because we were in a hotel. You know, like, normally when you're in a team and you're all in your own houses and stuff and you want to replace a player, you don't actually physically have to confront the person about it, which sounds really bad. It sounds like really bitchy and catty that you wouldn't have to do that. But like to physically see the person every day and then to have and be thinking in the back of your mind, we need to replace this guy. Like he went through the same shit that I just went through with the community, just absolutely hating on you for your performances. Like people hated on me because I open my mouth and I say some really stupid shit from time to time. But like his was, he was kind of like me. We were like the faces of like Australian Counter-Strike, the guy with the beard and the guy with the stupid hair. And he was just copying like so much abuse. And I know exactly how hard that must have been for him because it was shit. And I feel horrible that the team wasn't there for him more. Like we weren't there to support him more or try and facilitate him to get out of the slump. Like I regret not trying to facilitate that more. It's not something at the time that I thought, like, you know, I didn't think that he was playing badly for any reason. He would just seem like he was slumping. So like if I'd taken more time, maybe we could have fixed it and we could have facilitated him more. But it got to the point where he wasn't performing and we had to do something about it. And we had a discussion as a team, and it's so hard to have a discussion as a team when you're all in the same living environment. And like we had to go, we're in like Gomez's room, like me and Gomez for, I swear, like I didn't leave the room for like 6 hours. And like, I'm on the floor with like pillows on my face as we're discussing the decision. I'm like, I really don't want to do this. Like, I don't want to do this. Like, this is a decision that they, and it was just so hard to, like, first of all, get to the point where we're like, okay, we have to do this. Like, this has to happen for the team to move forward. And then to, it's the courage. Like, come on, man. Like, nobody likes breaking up with a person. That's kind of what it was, you know? Like,
yeah.
And to get to the courage to do that. And then we spoke about how we're going to do it. Am I going to go do it one-on-one? Like, is Gomez going to do it because he's the manager? Are we going to, like, completely bitch it and get the owners of our team to go and do it? Are we going to do it as a team? Where are we going to do it? Like,
it was like, just, you got to take him out for dinner or some shit. Like,
what do you do?
Yeah. And,
like, we the way we ended up doing it, like, was we just went down to, like, I think we were in the lobby or some shit. Like, it's pretty quiet, like, where we were. It wasn't like we took him somewhere in public so he couldn't, like, rage and bash us all up or something. It was like, and I just sat there and I said, like, hey, man, like, we're gonna replace you. Like, that's it. And he took it really well. Like, he took it really, really well. He was like, yeah, I kind of figured this was coming. You know, I know that I haven't been performing and stuff and all that kind of stuff. And it was sad. Like, it was because it's not like we're a European player or like an American player. If you get removed from a team, you have the likelihood of, you know, going and playing for another team and still being a professional Counter-Strike player. It's we're taking the thing which this guy loves and his current employment, and we're ripping it away, and we're saying you're going on a 30-hour plane ride home, and you have nothing. And that's what we did, and it sucked. Like, it, and I, like, when we said goodbye, like, everybody gave Luke a hug and stuff, and I everybody, like, literally everybody besides me gave Luke a hug, like, he was getting in the Uber. I couldn't do it. Like, I felt so responsible for fucking this guy over. Like, I didn't know if he wanted a hug from me. I didn't know. I felt so bad. Like, I was just like, this is horrible. It's a horrible.
You must have talked about it since, though, because you and Luke were always tight, right?
Look, to be honest with you, we haven't really. Like, I feel like a cunt. Like, when that stuff happens, like, it's almost like it's worse for me than breaking up with a girl. Like, I don't know why that sounds really gay, but, like, it's just like I feel like I fucked this guy over, and I'm embarrassed. Not embarrassed. I'm ashamed to, like, I don't know. I just suck at, like, relationships like that when they end. Like, I don't know how to deal with it. Like, is there any animosity towards me? Like, I don't know. I don't think there's, like, a broken fence or anything. Like, if I message Luke right now and said, hey, man, how you going? How you been? Like, he's not gonna be like, fuck you, Chad, like, or ignore me or anything.
Yeah, of course not, right?
But I just, yeah, like, it's just shit.
Yeah, well, you know? I mean, look, this sort of stuff happens, and here's the thing, like, real talk, if you guys hadn't have got together and done it, it probably would have been took out of your hands anyway. The org probably would have intervened, you know. Maybe that would have been better, you know. I always say, like, kind of when you're in management positions, the best thing to always do is always, if you need to, distance yourself from the decision. So you blame it on your boss, right? And that's great, because that person doesn't have a relationship with them. They're the faceless enemy. You can just fucking palm it all on them. Like, it's bloody come from corporate. You've got to go. You just play it like that. And people might say that's spineless or whatever, but it generally keeps the relationship intact, prevents any immediate conflict, any weird emotions pouring over, you know, because it's come from, you know, it's come from somebody that this person can't potentially interact with. But, I'd have thought you guys would have been straight back to just talking and chilling now, because he's around, he's back in the team, right?
Well, he's not, I don't think he's actively playing at the moment. The legacy thing, like, that he did, I don't know if it was, like, just because he didn't have anything else going and he wanted to keep playing Counter-Strike, I'm not quite sure, but that's no longer happening. I don't think that team's around anymore.
He looks very happy on Facebook. He's traveling with his girlfriend or something, taking all these glamorous photos, you know.
It was his birthday the other day.
Yeah.
You know, he's at the end of his mid-20s now, unfortunately, the poor guy.
Oh, fucking grown up. I remember when that guy didn't even shave.
Oh, he's baby-faced like me. Yeah. That's why we got to keep, like, a little bit of the stubble. Otherwise, it just looks fucked. Like, I'm 20. I'm almost 27, and I still look like I have a baby face. So we got to do something about it. But no, like, I've only been back home for what, 2 weeks. It's not that I couldn't have spoken to him online and shit. It's just like, I'm just settling back in. I spent the last, every waking moment that my girlfriend wasn't at work for the last week and a bit, we spent together, because now, like I said before, she's gone to Europe for 6 weeks. So kind of now I'll get my life back together, and well, not back together, but I'll start focusing on the important things, I guess, as of today. That was sad.
Yeah, well, it's always tough. You were talking a lot about the kind of hate you were getting, and the hate Luke had got kind of before you. I think it's funny, actually, because by removing Luke, you kind of removed your lightning rod, right? Like, you were next in line to get fucked. So there's a karmic element to it. If you've got any guilt whatsoever, you paid for it many times.
When Luke was slumping, I was playing well. Like, that's the thing. Like, and that's, I don't know if it's because, like, then when I removed him, like, as me setting up bad structures as an in-game leader, I fell into whatever roles he was doing. So that's why I was then being the player who was shit. I think it's just I was shit, so that's probably, like, easier. But when Luke was struggling, I was, like, playing quite well. And in practice and stuff, like, when we were playing, this is a thing, and I don't want to be one of those guys who's like, well, in practice. But in practice, I was fine. I was a good player. I contributed. I did my jobs. I played my role. I facilitated my teammates. I made good calls. And then when we get to the lands and we play the important events, I'm just a choking noob. Like, I never felt in practice that I couldn't compete with these guys. It's just when I was actually needed to stand up and be that guy, I couldn't do it. And that sucks. Like, that really sucks to know that you can do it in an environment where obviously the pressure's not as high, and then to go to do it on the day and not perform, like, that's worse than, like, not being able to get an erection. Like, man, this is with thousands and thousands of people watching. At least if I didn't get an erection, that's just one girl I'm disappointing. But
it can be thousands and thousands of people if you want.
It depends if you leave the webcam on.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, do you think of that period then? Like, you think you were choking? Like, legitimately choking? Like, you just had a fucking mental block or something?
I obviously am not a fantastic player.
Mm.
My stats from, like, all comps in CSGO are not fantastic. I had a couple of performances where I played good. Like, I'm not going to say I did anything fantastic. Like, I never put the team on my back and carried them across the line single-handedly. But I contributed really heavily and well in some matches that were relatively important to play to get us, like, the victories. So I don't think I could say I was just choking. Like, I'm obviously I wasn't a star player. I just think that maybe, well, it must be. It must have been choking in some way. But I wasn't a great player. There has to be a better fit from.
Yeah.
This is the thing. The boys can choose from now. They can pick a player from Europe. They can pick a player from America. They can pick a player from anywhere they want. You know, this is the thing. There's no, and if they're gonna, I don't know what their plans are, to be completely honest with you. Like, it's not something which I've heavily discussed with them. Like, me and Gomez have talked about it a little bit, but they still haven't decided who they want to get as a fifth, as far as I'm aware. And I think that could be to do with, you know, they don't know where they're going in terms of organization.
Yeah. But, I mean, someone will pick them up for sure.
We had offers when I was still on the team, so, you know.
Well, while we're talking about that, anything you can divulge, anything you can talk about? You know,
organization-wise?
Yeah, because, like, I mean, I know.
For the team?
Yeah. No, but I mean, for when you were there, because I know you had a few offers. So, I don't know if you want to talk about it. You don't have to.
So, the one which we had the day of the E-League semi-final was Immortals. And it was like, they sat down with us in the lobby of our hotel and they said, we want to go ahead with you guys. And then, now, this is, I obviously was on the stage warming up at this point, but apparently, like, maybe like an hour before our match versus Cloud9, they pulled the offer and told us they weren't going to go with us, which means they're obviously going to go with Tempo. So that we didn't get told that until after the game, but, like, it's kind of like we just lost. And then to come back and go, Immortals aren't interested in you.
That's a double
anymore.
Kick in the balls,
like,
mate.
That's a double kick in the spuds. Sick. Like, that really sucked. And I don't know. I can speculate as to why that fell apart. I think we were probably getting sold for more than Tempo were. And Tempo, like, obviously, Tempo have had much better results than us recently. So for me, like, I would have picked up Tempo too if I was the Immortals, let's be honest. They're a team who has, like, a lot of potential. They just won, what was it, DreamHack? Like, they're a sick team. And I think we were, yeah, we were getting sold for more than what they were getting sold for, which doesn't make a lot of sense. I guess we had an E-League spot, whereas Tempo didn't. So maybe that gave us a bit more value. But in terms of teams and, like, prospects and going forward, like, I think it makes sense to pick them. But, yeah, I think, yeah, we, I don't know how much it was. We're at least getting, I think it was like a couple of hundred thousand or at least $100,000 more than what they were being sold for. So just didn't happen. What other offers? Just trying. There was nothing like ever super concrete, like other than that Immortals one. Like there was like a Call of Duty team that was apparently interested. I don't know if they're a big one. I think they're in like, what's it called? Champions League or whatever it is in Call of Duty. One of the, like, they're a decent team, but they're not a big known organization.
Yeah, I get them.
I think that's about it. Like, we didn't really hear too much about offers or whatever like that. You probably know more than I would about that. About the offers.
maybe.
Yeah.
But I keep my cards close to my chest. These are your stories. They're not mine.
That's all I got. So
anyway, I was following on from the Luke thing, and I was going to ask you about, you know, social media and kind of coping with hate, which hasn't been your strong suit of late. Although, again, that surprised me because that always seemed to be something you'd been really good at dealing with in the past. But this time it really got on top of you, and you even went to the lengths of deactivating your Twitter for a while. And I knew you'd be back, but talk me through all of that. Like, what was the straw that broke the camel's back? Like, and when did it really start to get to you? Because it never used to.
Yeah, like I think I said it in an interview with old mate Joshy Raven that I used to think I was a strong person, like I thick skinned. You know, I used to think that about myself because I look at all of the gamers out there, and this is blanket. And I think if people are going to say, nah, I was a cool kid in school and, you know, nothing ever bothered me, then cool. You're probably lying to yourself. But as a blanket for most of the people in this industry, no matter whether you're like a caster or a player, whatever you do, you probably weren't the most popular kid in school and you probably had a lot of insecurities and you probably still today have a bit of anxiety, which in the gaming world, we all like release. Like this is a thing I was talking to some, you know, kids who kind of followed my stream and stuff about this, and I was telling them, like, me, like a guy who comes across as really confident and I'm able to like stand up in front of thousands of people and talk like there's nobody there, I still have like pretty bad social anxiety, so I don't know how I coped with it in the beginning. Like, I guess the hate wasn't for me, it was an overnight change, right? When Vox Seminar was around and Gfinity and all that stuff happened, like, sick, these Australians, you know, they just wear thongs, they have stupid hair, they yell, like, oh my god, look, they took a map off Fnatic, they took a map off Nip, these guys are sick, like, we love these guys, right? And that's what we kind of had while we were Vox. We became Renegades, expectations immediately changed, I said some stupid shit.
We'll talk about that. I don't think it was stupid. I don't think it was.
I know that people are always going to, there's always going to be some people that love you and some people that hate you, right? And in the beginning, it was kind of like manageable to deal with the people that hated you because they were the minority. But as it transitioned and the people that hated became the majority, or at least it seemed to me that they were the majority, and then I was becoming more and more conscious of how I was negatively influencing the results of the team in terms of scoreboard, that's kind of when it all like clicked, right? I was like, I just can't deal with this anymore because I felt bad enough. I didn't need, every time I opened Twitter or every time I jumped on Reddit or every time like I have my Facebook page up or my Snapchat or something like that and I had someone abusing me, like going, you fucking shit, you should quit, kill yourself. Like, it's amazing how many people are happy to throw around kill yourself. Like, I hope you get cancer and die. Like, just stuff like that. Like,
anything worse? Anything targeted and specific? They're always the best ones. I think when people, like, I don't know, they'll message you and it'll be like your address or your postcode or something, and they'll be like, I'm going to come and fucking cut your throat while you sleep. But like, I mean, I get that.
You get that?
Oh, yeah, I had during the height of the Reddit thing, I had someone like basically message, like, they must have used a geolocator on my Skype, so it's somebody that I've known at some point or somebody that knows somebody I know, and they messaged me on a throwaway. Basically with like my kind of area. So it was like, I know you live in Edgbaston in Birmingham and I'm going to come there and I'm going to rape your girlfriend. I was,
yeah, all right.
Now, the funny thing about that is, and you know, I say funny, obviously, loosely, but she worked in a particularly dangerous profession anyway, and used to get raped threats, death threats all the time. So we were on like a police hotline. So if at any point there's ever any disturbance around our house, it's like it just goes through straight away. Like, so if anybody had turned up to do anything, they probably would have found themselves getting an armed response unit in their face. But yeah, that's the kind of stuff I was dealing with.
I had like people, I don't know, because I as soon as like I started reading it and it was negative, I just would like close off it. So like I'd get like emails and stuff that were like really long, and they were like telling like how I lost them thousands of dollars worth of skins, and if I ever come to an event in their country, they're going to come and bash me and stuff, and all that, like that level. But like, it was never to the point of like, I know that you live in this place. Like, I guess everyone
Australia
would know where
I was
living.
Australia's pretty big, I guess, though, dude. So.
They have a long way to come.
And it's far away. Like, who's going to fly 30 hours to kick your ass, you know?
Yeah, so that's probably a bit different. But yeah, no, I never had anybody going that extreme. But it felt like being loved and then being hated. It's just like, obviously, day and night. And it was just so quick. Like, it just happened so quick. It obviously transitioned over a period of time because, like, I wasn't. What I said when, obviously this is when we had Luke and Luke was slumping and I was like, I said a couple of things and then people hated me for saying those things. I wasn't playing bad at the same time. I wasn't playing as bad. So like that was okay. And then obviously this year I was playing poorly and people still bringing up the stuff that I said and they're bringing it up like I said it like a week ago and it all just became too much coupled with, you know, not necessarily enjoying what I was doing. The thing that I loved was going to events and getting to see the people who were fans and getting to talk to all the other players and stuff. And the social side of it like that was great. And obviously competing, right? Mm. They were the best parts. But having like really long practice days where it didn't feel like we were getting any better, or like some weeks we felt like we were sick and then other weeks we were doing terribly. And then like all the social media hate and all that, like it all just built up over time. And I think the MLG thing was... it was a coping mechanism, you know. It wasn't like I felt I had to turn it off. And people are like, well, just don't open it. But I think a lot of people in our community are probably addicted to social media in some way. Like we're a bunch of kids. Like the best players in the world are all like quite young, and they have thousands of people loving them on social media and like, you know, just saying, oh my god, I want to. They are people who want to be them, and like. You get that love and attention on social media, right? So why would you not want to open it and feel good about yourself? That's what all these players have. And that was what I had until people like started hating me. So it was kind of feeding my ego, I suppose. And then when it turned, it was crushing me.
Mm. You should look, I don't know if you ever follow Total Biscuit at all, but obviously I know John and been on a few shows with him and whatnot. And he's talked about this quite openly, as is his wife, about how he, you know, huge YouTube, you know, 3 million fucking followers or some subscribers or something along those lines. And he says he's addicted to it. Like he absolutely has to go and read the criticism. He can't detach himself from it. He's had his IP blocked on Reddit and he uses a VPN to get around it. So he can expose himself to that shit. They disabled comments on his YouTube. He doesn't run his Twitter anymore. He has like one of his staff do that for him. He's tried to completely. He's got his own subreddit, which is very popular. Doesn't interact there, and it's just like because of how thoroughly depressed it would leave him feeling. And obviously, recently he's been battling cancer. So he just needs that like sort of positive mindset. Yeah. But he talked about it, and you know, he actually used to say addicted as well. It's never anything I've felt, but I do have a strange compulsion to seek out what people are saying about me.
I love the way you deal with the haters. It's so good. Like a lot of people like it.
Not everyone does.
But like when you just retweet it and you just, it's basically like if everybody, I love how in Korea, like when I was over there talking to Susie and Monty and stuff, and they're like, yeah, like you can only have like one account and it's actually tied to you. Like if you go online and you like harass somebody, they know who you it is and they can sue you for it. Like, and that's fantastic. Like imagine if every idiot that jumped online and abused you like, and they're saying like things that obviously aren't true, or like they're threatening you and stuff. And you could immediately just see who that person is and go, all right, buddy, well, you know, they wouldn't do it. Nobody would do it. Mm. And the thing is, like, that's why I love about what you do. You're just making people look like morons. You just retweet it to all your followers. And then it's just the pack mentality of people are like, this guy's an idiot. And yeah, they just get on board, and then hopefully the person wakes up to themselves and sees they're an idiot. But it's fantastic when they tweet that, more.
That's always been the mindset. So a lot of people think that I do it specifically to kind of like, I don't know, woe is me, or whatever. It's really just to fucking highlight the stupidity of what they're saying. And I do know that somebody who follows me might want to tell this person what they're doing is stupid, what they're saying is wrong, or correct them. And I've been told quite expressly, especially now that I work for Turner, any nonsense on social media is not going to fly. So I have to not be quite as vicious as I used to be. But now I can just retweet and be like, look, this is what this individual said. This is how ridiculous some of these people are. And you're right. I think people will basically do to them what they're doing to me. And you're right. I think, and I've had people... Literally, so there was even recently, there was a guy who has harassed me for fucking years, literally years on Reddit. Every piece of work that was ever about me, he's there, like one of the first people. Anyway, we figured all out, like his Twitter account and everything. And obviously, my followers have been growing and growing. And he said something on Twitter and I got wind of it. And basically, I just fucking highlighted it and said, this is the moron who's been, like, you know, abusing me. And these are the things that he's saying. These are the things that he's doing. And he's had a complete fucking breakdown. Like, literally, he couldn't handle 4 hours of what he's been giving me for 2 fucking years. Yeah. You know? And he's, like, blocked me on Twitter. He deleted his Twitter account. He's, like, set up this mad, rambling, incoherent blog about how sorry he is and how he wants to change. And, like, just a complete mental collapse. And you know, I think to myself, like, well, okay, now imagine your times 2,000, let's say.
Yeah.
And every day you log on to a PC, that's what you have to deal with. So, yeah, I make no bones about it. I'll try and turn the mirror on people. That's what I think that's the best way to do it, right? Like, eye for an eye and all that, you know?
Well, a lot of people disagree with that, but I'm all for that. Like, a guy yesterday, I made a tweet about, I think it was like Fnatic's worst ever scoreline with this lineup or something along those lines, right? And some guy tweeted at me and goes, haha, like you're 16 zeros. I'm like, the guy actually had a picture of himself. So respect for that on Twitter. It's very rare that these guys have photos of themselves. The reply I was going to make, I was just going to grab that photo and just draw a dick on his face and then just retweet it. But I drew the picture. I wonder if I've still got it. I probably deleted it. But then
you're a free man.
I should have done it. Yeah, I don't know why I didn't do it. But like, that was going to be my reply. So it's not as good as actually proving a guy wrong. Like,
no, it's not as sophisticated. But come on, Aussie humor's never been known for its sophisticated wit. But no, I think it's terrible. I think what social media has done is it's given people this like very direct access to people they wouldn't ordinarily be allowed to exchange opinions with. And sometimes that can be a great thing, because I'm like you. Like, the best part about this job for me is connecting with fans. Anybody who's met me will know. Like, I don't look at somebody and say, you're a fan. You're a person who enjoys my work and you want to get to know me, and we'll talk and we'll hang out for as long as I can physically do it. And, you know, some people are a bit weird, you know, like, and some people aren't. That's just a lot of averages, like, but I'll talk to anybody. Now, but unfortunately, social media really has given a lot of people this idea that, like, oh, I can just tweet at this individual. Like, when I see deluded fucking people, like people I even respect, they like tweet at like the Donald Trump Twitter account as if Donald Trump has ever logged into that in his fucking, what are you doing, Donald? Are you crazy? You know, that you're not, first of all, it's not Donald Trump. Second of all, why the fuck would a presidential candidate give a fuck what you think on Twitter? Yeah. Do you think, like, that's a good point, hot dude, 42? Never happening, is it? So, honestly, it's so retarded. But, yeah, like, just the idea of, like I said, this immediacy, that it's, like, all those people who've, like, you've just lost the game. You're feeling pretty bad anyway. So they can just reach out to you and be like, you cost me skin. You did this, you did that. Like, pour on this misery because they've got that level of access. I think it's just really repellent. You know, actually what people use social media for, given like everything it can actually be used for.
I had like an unspoken rule for myself where after we played a tournament, if we lost, which this is obviously a horrible way, I should probably do this, should have done this regardless, but if we lost, I wouldn't check Twitter for at least 48 hours. Mm. And then by that point, all of the negative tweets would be that far down in my like notification feed that I would never actually deal with them. So like that's a way that I like started to deal with it when I reactivated my Twitter. Because like we still had some results that were like, they weren't fantastic. I think people expected a lot from us. We expected a lot from ourselves. But like, it's just one of those things that, like you're saying, it's different from actual sports and stuff where I'm sure like you're saying, like Donald Trump doesn't check his. I'm sure LeBron James doesn't check his. I'm sure like Steph Curry doesn't check his. Like,
I don't know, actually. There's a lot of people in the leagues, like, you know, league executives, commissioners, team managers, team owners, that I would wish their players wouldn't actually go on Twitter. Because that's other thing it does. Yeah, because at the other end, it gives the illusion. Like, okay, I've seen this so many times. Like, there was a Liverpool footballer who, like, said something about, like, 9/11 or something. And, you know, it's just like, first of all, you're a soccer player, mate. No one really gives a fuck about your political insight. Second of all, I think he did it on the anniversary of it. You know, Jesus. It's just like, and you're just like, this is just a f-, and then, delete. There's no delete.
Don't they get media training?
Well, this is the thing. I don't think a lot of them do. And you know, the sad thing about social media is if you've got an ego anyway, if you're a narcissist, it makes you feel important. You've got this little number of followers. You see all the retweets going out. And you think, I can just spew my fucking thoughts out to the world. No one gives a fuck. That's why I used to be called Twatter. No one cares. Like, it was just a bunch of self-important dickheads. Oh, today I had a sandwich. I might do that again. Brilliant. Nice. Awesome. Really, really important stuff. And it just seems to bring out the worst in people on both ends of the spectrum. I see a lot of people tweeting stuff. I've done it myself, obviously. I've tweeted stuff. I'll tweet my opinions about stuff, and I'm trying to be a bit more savvy about it. But sometimes I've just gone in on people for no fucking reason. Like, yeah. I think the work you're doing is shit. Why am I saying that on Twitter? Like, I don't really know why I'm doing it. You know, to what end does it serve? Especially if I know these people and I can like just approach them at an event and be like, you know, and do it that way. But what I went through a phase where what I realized was, every time I got in an argument with somebody more famous than me, which was everyone back then, right? I'd gain like 200 followers.
Yeah.
Just that day. Because people were like, oh, this guy's keeping it real. I'm not. I'm just being a fucking prick.
Yeah. But
this guy's keeping it real. Let's all follow him. So, like, I mean, pretty much a lot of people I respect and consider friends now. Again, I'm talking about Total Biscuit. That's what we did. We went back and forth at each other on Twitter before we even met each other in person. And I got a lot of followers after that. Same with all the Evil Geniuses thing, going after all the StarCraft players and stuff like that. So there was this phase I went through when I realized being an asshole can actually pay off. But like, again, I kind of look back on that and it's a little bit cringy, I think.
Yeah, well, like you're saying, I used to go in on people, like on forums and stuff. Like, not on Twitter so much, because like, I haven't been on Twitter for that long. I think it's like 2 years or some shit. But like before that, on forums, like I'd go all in on people. Like, I've even gone in on people on Reddit, like in the last 6 months, I reckon. Like, there was a guy, like, same thing as what you're saying, you know, the guy like following your work for such a long period of time. This guy might have been like commenting on anything to do with me or anything to do with Renegades for like, I don't know, a couple of months. And I was just like, I don't know. I don't even remember what I said, but I just like had enough. And that's the thing with, well, like with social media, what we're saying is at any point you can say whatever you want to anybody and the repercussions are basically nothing. Even like I guess like we can't go in and say like, I hope that all of the Christians in the world burn in hell, which would be quite ironic. Or like something like really, really, like really bad. Like, I want to join ISIS. Like, cause there's obviously repercussions to those things. The same, but like we can go in on just some little guy on a forum somewhere and not a lot's going to happen from it. And like, I think it's good and bad in that way, but I just hate the fact that there's no filter. Like, people still treat the internet like it was 10 years ago. 10 years ago, I can completely get it. I understand. I was playing Counter-Strike and people were going, you have a little girl's voice, and abusing me as a 14-year-old. I was being a bit older than that 10 years ago, but I thought it would have changed. I thought at some point, now that like my parents and stuff have Facebook and my dad has a Twitter account and stuff, you know, at some point the internet has to change where people, you know, have a filter. Well, just can't
a lot of people would strongly object to what you're proposing, and would invoke, you know, free speech issues and free speech rights and all this stuff. You know, if you take away my right to anonymously harass Spunj, Counter-Strike player, you know, you're impeding my potential rights to do other things, to say other things. You know, where is the line drawn for fair criticism? And I remember all my trouble with Reddit stemmed from this. Mm. The idea that I didn't want a bunch of anonymous people having direct influence and indeed dominion over my fucking livelihood. I didn't want that. I still obviously don't. And you know, a group of people who manage a big subreddit, if they take a disliking to your content. I mean, when you consider, we're now at the stage where Reddit's so big, there's even an argument to say that it's potentially subverting the American democratic process, because obviously they aren't allowing a sort of equal and proportionate amount of information to be shared about both, or I should say still technically three candidates, you know, that they're not doing that. That's the argument. I mean, Facebook was in the news for this recently as well. They were deleting conservative material from people's feeds and not allowing it to show up, banning conservative and right-wing Facebook pages while over promoting leftist and liberal ones that weren't news at all, and using their own personal politics, really. So I think I can see the problem that once we start saying, hey, you know, like everyone's got to have a linked account and everything you say online has to have a real life consequence. But just speaking as someone that's been the, you know, victim of like some pretty sustained harassment, I do find it hard to sympathize with like this idea that this is my, you know, this is my face, this is my name. You know exactly who I am. I'm accountable for everything I say and do, but you're not. And yet people are telling me, you know, I'm the bad guy. Right, because I've got a following on it. It really feels like the game is rigged in that sense.
I guess people would argue like we choose to be in the limelight. You know, like I guess that's what celebrities, you know, they're like, oh, we don't want paparazzi following us everywhere, and people go, well, you know, don't be a celebrity then. That's pretty rough, really, when you think about it, right?
Yeah, but they do it to sports fans as well, don't they? They say if you don't want the details of your love life to be on the front page of the Sun, you shouldn't be famous. It's the price of fame. I hate this. Like, I mean, did anyone come up to you when you started as a Counter-Strike player saying this game's going to become big and you're going to be on TV one day? So sign here because now you're fair game for every cunt on the internet. Well, no, because I don't know how many people would enter into that Faustian pact. You know, I don't think many people would, and I certainly didn't, and I don't think it's fair. But as I'm getting older, I am sort of just becoming a bit more like weary about even fighting the battle. It just seems to be okay. It's not fair. It's not right. But this is how it is, and we've just got to kind of make do, I think. We've just got to tolerate it. So, which isn't a particularly pleasant thought, but...
No, I think, though, like, it's just, like you're saying, just got to deal with it, really. And that's kind of the way that I think a lot of people, they just deal with it. Like, I've talked to other pros and stuff, I'm sure you have as well, at events. And, like, even people who are loved, like the Brazilians, like Fallen and Cold Zero and stuff, as soon as they lose a match, it's the same for them. They go from being these guys who are loved and admired to absolutely hated. And like their community of like the Brazilians can be pretty fucking like rough on them from what like they were like. I was talking to them about it and they were like, yeah, like, you know, you can cop all these messages of love and then the next day you got all these messages of hate. And they're one of the most, you know, loved teams in the whole world right now. So it happens to everybody. I think just got to deal with it.
What do you think about skins gambling?
I've never. See, I'm proud of this. I don't know if I should be. I've never gambled in Counter-Strike. I'll have a punt. You know, I'll go and have a bet. Like the other day, I had a bet on the AFL and I lost. But I was prepared to lose. And that's the thing that I think is with gambling with skins is the kids are not prepared to lose because they're
either
not.
Do you think kids are doing it then?
Oh, definitely. You'd have to be naive to think they aren't, really. Like, how easy is it to jump on like a CSGO gambling site? Like, it's as easy as anything. And kids nowadays, Jesus, I can't imagine what they're doing on the internet. Because if I had the internet when I was a 12-year-old kid, I can imagine the stuff I would have been looking up. But yeah, with the access to skins and these websites being so so frequent and easy. It's definitely happening with the kids. I don't think it's good. Like I was sponsored by Alpha Draft, right? Like mm-hmm. it was a gambling thing. But I tried not to, where I could, I tried not to promote the pay money to actually compete in it or play it. I would mm-hmm. always try to promote the free tournaments that they were doing, you know, or if you're interested.
Yeah, and I think I will say this. I do think, you know, there's a distinction with fantasy drafting. Yeah, you're doing it for money. But I mean, I look at something like that, and I think, you know, I'm kind of cool with that. That's very much on the, and I don't have a problem with gambling at all. But like, I'm more worried about match betting because of the problems that come with it, in terms of match fixing. And then I'm more worried about lottery betting as well. Because that seems to be, you know, high stakes, little chance of return. A lot of people getting fleeced. And as we found out now, increasingly these sites are duping the people that participate by getting streamers to ultimately fake big wins.
Well, like if people did, I'm a skeptic. Like yeah. when that stuff's happening and I'm watching these guys, before any of this stuff happened where like Mo came out and said all this shit, I already assume that was the yeah. case. Like, how many pros are like going to do that stuff because they want to? Like, I'm sure there's some of them which like would want to, but there's not many who are going to do it just because. Like, oh, I'm going to, you know, bet all these Dragon Laws and hopefully, like, it's just not happening. You're not doing that on the stream. That's not the way that. It's not what you really want to be doing with your time. You're doing it because you're reaping a financial benefit, right? Like, that's what they're doing. So they obviously were getting something out of it, and they. You wouldn't be using tens of thousands of your own money to do it. Like some people who have gambling addictions, maybe. But from my, like, I wouldn't do it. There's no way. Like, I feel like being dishonest in that way to kids, which is there are a lot of kids. There must be. Like, that's, I think that's a huge demographic of Counter-Strike, right? Is pretty bad. Like, it's pretty. It's you're setting a bad example, and especially with gambling, right? I think like if you're old enough to know what you're doing and you're happy to lose, or even if you're young enough and you're happy to lose, then there's no problem. Like, you're like, all right, well, I lost that. Well, you know, I won't do it again, or I'll save up and get some more skins, and then I will do it again. But if you're going to sit there and you're going to blame somebody else for your loss, this is, I guess, like, I don't think it's good, and I don't think people should be promoting it in the way that they are. But you're responsible for yourself, like. If you're going to do it, that's on you at the end of the day. You yeah, can't be. I'm not making you bet.
That's the hardest part, right? Like, I want to come down and kind of condemn a lot of what I see that's going on in relation to skins gambling. It's created a lot of problems in the industry. And I agree, there's probably going to be a few people severely affected by it in a negative way. But what I don't want to do is ever be in a place where I'm basically advocating for a lack of self accountability. Personal accountability to me is very important, because it's when you start saying I'm not personally accountable for this, that's when you open yourself up to all kinds of like fucking, oh well, we need a nanny state, we need a government. I don't like that. I want to go the other way. I'm a grown up. I want to be able to make decisions about when to drink, what, you know, who, you know, all that other stuff that I can't say now because I'm corporate, all that other stuff that may or may not, you know. But I just think over your body, for example, you should have complete fucking dominion. I don't see why a government should tell me what the fuck I should be doing with it. So once you start advocating for like, yeah, but think of the children, and yeah, gambling is dangerous and it should be, once you start doing that, you're effectively saying, well, that should apply to all things that could be potentially vices. And that's a real fucking broad area. So that's why I'm nervous about coming out and beating that drum a bit too hard, because I think it opens us up to other bad things. Maybe.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I was watching the video you did the other day where you're talking about the skin stuff's going to be regulated, like the gambling.
Yeah,
I think it's going to become regulated. So like, that's going to, if people still want to gamble illegally, then they're still going to gamble illegally. Like, I'm sure it happens a lot in the States, where I didn't even realize that you couldn't, in Australia, I'm probably the same in the UK. You can just go on to like, say like sportsbet.com.au. Not that's I don't know why I bother with the .com.au, but you can just go on that website and you can gamble from literally anywhere in the country at any time on your phone. Like, yeah, no dramas. Like, I didn't realize people had
18
to fly.
Plus, but then how about it? Gamble.
Yeah, I don't know why, like, everybody has to go to Vegas to do it. I don't understand that restriction on it. Like, that to me, it doesn't make much sense. But, hey, I'm not American. I don't have
to. Yeah, I mean, they got a bit of a puritanical attitude to gambling. And I know a lot of people in sports would like this ban to be repealed because, of you know, obviously, it's a license to fucking print money. And people are going to bet with their friends anyway. And people have got, you know, ways around it. There's loopholes. And not just going to Vegas. You know, you've got other casinos as well. And now states are kind of voting on whether or not we're going to have, you know, partial gambling. So you're allowed fruit machines here and this kind of thing. So it's pretty crazy. But, like, you know, the one thing that I have noticed in Counter-Strike is that it definitely brought a new level of hate and abuse aimed at pros that they never had to deal with before. That because it wasn't there, because people weren't betting on their games. If you lost a game, people would just call you shit. But now, if you lose a game, somebody can not just say you're shit. You could have potentially cost them money, and they get very upset about it, especially if they don't have a lot of it, right? So, which most people don't. And I think that's like something that nobody really saw coming.
No, I when all that, like, I wasn't playing really any high stake matches and stuff when it first took off. So for me, like, I was pretty shielded from it. But everybody cops it. Everybody cops it now. Like, I think the Fnatic guys have probably copped it the worst to do with some of the gambling stuff, I think. But I don't understand why it's been allowed to go this long without any kind of reform. Because it's not like it's, you know, been going on for a short period of time. This is a pretty big deal now. There's lots of money getting thrown around. Like, you, someone's got to do something about it. And I think it has to be Valve, but whether they do or they don't remain to see, I guess.
Did you see the lawsuit?
Yeah, I did. I didn't read into it completely, but I read the buzzwords.
Yeah, so basically one dude is saying that Valve, obviously some guy got cleaned out. I mean, that's expressly said in the body of the lawsuit that he gambled as a minor and as an adult and lost money, and Valve have facilitated this illegal gambling. So he's opening up a class action to it. So it's the ultimate extension of, like, going on Twitter and moaning at a player. This guy went to a lawyer and they're moaning at Valve, pretty much. But the fact still remains that if anything were to come of this, if it were, and I think it will be classified as gambling. I saw the way what happened with fantasy drafting, which would always been given a special dispensation on the grounds it was a game of skill, not a game of chance. And they changed the laws around that recently when they found out that there was people doing dodgy stuff. So I think the same will happen here. And I think we're going to get a bunch of fucking regulations. And it could even be the end of skins betting as we know it, I think. Mm. Certainly within 6 months or so. But so here's the other question then. If that were to happen and skins gambling wasn't to exist, how much of a drop-off in viewing numbers do you think we'd see? Like, how badly affected do you think the game would be?
I don't know. Obviously, it'd affect people watching, like, all of the tournaments. I still think, like, the big ones, like the majors and stuff, are still going to get their big viewerships. I don't know how much of the community is only watching because they've bet on the game. I know it makes, like, an AFL game much more interesting for me, you know? If I can sit there and I've placed a bet on, like, Barlow to kick a goal and he doesn't, like, it makes the game a lot more interesting for me. But I don't know, maybe, like, this could be naive. I don't know, like, a 20% drop-off? It might even be more than that. I don't know.
I mean, it's really hard to say. Like, I did a small UK event, like, in 2014. And for the games that were on CSGO Lounge, we were getting, like, 80,000 watching the stream. Jesus, but for the games that weren't on Lounge, and this was just shit UK games, for the games that weren't on Lounge, it was, like, 10,000. So
yeah, right.
It was, like, eightfold, you know. So I don't know. A lot of people are very well, you know, a lot of community members. I don't know if it's anyone credible necessarily, but I see a lot of comments where people are very pessimistic about how many people would actually watch this game if it wasn't for skins. And certainly the unprecedented growth has happened during the time when we've had skins and skins betting has been a thing. Don't, obviously, correlation isn't causation, etc. But yeah, it's an interesting one for me. I'm kind of a little bit... I'm interested to see where it goes, because I think we've got big changes coming this year. certainly by 2017, we're gonna have a very different landscape.
Yeah, it wasn't really something which I'd bothered putting too much thought into. Like, it kind of just was a natural growth.
Yeah,
from my perspective, anyway, it wasn't something where I was like, oh, you know, I wasn't benefiting anymore because of skins being in the game. I know I became a like paid professional, but I had that before in Source, and there wasn't any skins. There was just a man in a cowboy hat.
Yeah, indeed. So here's something I want to get talking about. You keep referring to these stupid things that you said. I don't think they were stupid. So this is obviously when you were in Renegades, and you know, you talked about how your team deserved respect, and you guys were as good as some of the US teams, if not better, and you were capable of beating them. And obviously, we all know by now what was said. I think it was all fair and valid. I think you were perfectly entitled to say what you said. Just to reiterate, you said that Renegades deserved more respect, that they were capable of beating the US teams, and people had been saying all these negative things about them that were ridiculous. And I thought that was all fair and valid. I honestly thought that you had a point, and that you had like come in for a lot of undue criticism. And then, of course, it was compounded by the fact that after you said those things, that's when the 16-0 occurred, which, you know, is a fucking, as a punchline, That's pretty good.
Funny, right?
Yeah, it's a pretty fucking strong one, right? It's a good fucking joke. So, like, you're saying these things are stupid. I don't think they are. I thought the community reaction was fucking stupid, honestly.
Well, I think it's just for people to go, haha, look at this idiot. He just said all this shit and then he gets 16-0. Like, that's fine. Like, I'm not going to sit there and defend that. We got slammed, right? Yeah. I think the stuff I was saying, I say it's stupid, I guess, because of the reaction I got out of it. Whereas, like, at the time, I wouldn't have said it if I thought it was stupid. And the reason, like, at the I Buy Power event that I said that stuff was, and this is why I shouldn't read shit on the internet, is I read a Gosu Gamer write-up. Now, I don't know if you like Gosu Gamer. I don't know what your position is on them. I think they're morons.
Well, yeah, here's the thing. So their lists and articles, like, I'd always been criticizing them. But then they gave me, like, some honorary lifetime achievement award. Right? So now I think they're really cool and intelligent. Okay. And, you know, they have impeccable taste. No, I mean, I think you're right. I think some of the coverage they've done in CS is pretty subpar, to be honest.
I don't want to put like a blanket over the whole website, but whoever wrote that article, I don't know, whichever dickhead he was, he basically wrote it and said we had absolutely no chance against CLG. Now, like, if you were a reputable journalist or like a website, or like you had any interest in Counter-Strike at all, you would know in the past matches when we had played CLG, I think we had played them at ESWC and we'd played them at some other event, and we, at that point, like, we'd play them twice on LAN, and we'd never lost. Like, okay, it's only twice, but sure. But wouldn't that be, like, enough of a record not to completely write a team off? Like,
yeah, of course, yeah.
I don't know. Like, I try to look at things, like, pretty fairly. I'm not just going to say, yeah, they're just shit. Like, some teams are just shit. That's fine. Some players do just suck. But you have to give people, or, like, base things off of merit. And, like, we hadn't lost to them at that point. And then we beat them again. And, you know, I just felt like to be completely disregarded, considering, you know, we weren't a team that sucked. Like, I think then we were, like, still in the top 20 in the world at that point, you know? It just, to me, made no sense. And I shouldn't have done it, because I'm sure nobody reads Gosu Gamer, let's be honest. But if I just left it, it would have been what it was. People were like, yay, they won. And then if we got 16-0, okay, whatever. But it was a good storyline. Like,
yeah.
made for some decent entertainment for people. Gave them something to have a laugh about. Yeah.
Was it going through your mind while you were playing that game? Like, as the rounds are going up, you think, fucking hell, not now. 16-0 me any other day, but not the day I say this shit.
I didn't think we were going to get 16-0'd. Like, I don't know what, because Cobble for us at that point in time was like a pretty strong map. And then it just kept happening and happening and happening, you feel really helpless. Like, you feel like there's no way back into it, but you just expect somebody's going to get a round where they get three kills and you win the round. You know, like the law of averages. We had to, you think the round was going to get in there eventually.
Yeah.
And then it just happened and I was pretty embarrassed, but you know, I don't think what I said made us get 16-0'd. Like, there's no direct link.
Oh,
there.
No, I don't believe that either. I know some people probably fucking tried to say it, like, oh, you were overconfident, you underestimated your opponents or some shit, but I know that's the two definitely aren't linked. I just thought it was really weird. It was just seemed like such a strange thing to, like, seize upon and be like, oh, we fucking hate this guy. Because, like, I always thought Counter-Strike was more robust than that, you know?
People think. Now, I was like, people have painted me with a brush that I'm like arrogant and like,
yeah, it's so weird.
And that like, I don't know. Like, I don't know how they get that from what I said. Like, all I said was that I thought that we deserved more respect. I don't know how that makes me arrogant. Like, yeah. I've said some stuff in the past where like, there was the Gfinity event where I said some stuff. I got asked a question by Banks about what I thought about like, US Counter-Strike, and at that time US Counter-Strike was in a bit of a pit, like,
yeah, it was, weren't
doing fantastically, and like I said, like with all this money and backing and stuff behind them, which they still do, I guess, have the lion's share compared to like the rest of the world, that I felt that they should have been doing better, and I think they also thought the same about themselves, but people thought like that was me like attacking America, like fuck American Counter-Strike. That's not it at all. Like I just thought that with the resources they had at their disposal that they should have been performing better, and then, well, the same thing happened to us. We had the resources at our disposal in some regard and we didn't perform fantastically, but at no point did I ever make excuses like people are saying for our bad performances once we were a professional team. It was like, okay, well, we played badly, we need to do better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was no oh well, you know, we were jet lagged or none of that. That was never something which came out of my mouth as a professional player. It's something people would always as interviewers ask you about. It's like, oh, you know, really long travel to get here, and you have to respond accordingly. You can't go, nah, you know, just a plane. Well, no, it is 30 hours of travel to get somewhere. It is a pretty big deal when you travel further than anybody else in the world, you know. But it's not an excuse, and it should have never been like taken as an excuse. I don't understand how people think that I am, or I was arrogant or egotistical, or like, I was a whiny baby. There's like a couple of people on Twitter who are opinionated, and when they give their opinions, they just get painted with the brush of being a whiny child, and all they do is complain.
Yeah.
One of them was me. Another one that comes to mind is MSL, and a lot of the stuff which he says he has valid points about, like talking about formats or that kind of stuff, and they're questions which should be discussed. But the way that, and like Fallen for a point there when he was like saying, why isn't Tempo invited to all these events and stuff, and there was something else that happened with Fallen that people didn't particularly like. But then like you make controversial posts like that, well, controversial, like, come on, let's be honest. Expressing your opinion on something which is meant to, is a platform for that, and they just go, no, you're a little bitch. All right, well, you know, what do you want from me? So I think the community always wants somebody to belittle or somebody to hate on, and I was just that person at the time. And people latched onto that. Like, I might have, you know, overstepped my bounds, and it's funny. It's funny that we got 16-0'd and stuff, and it gives people, you know, a reason to go, ha, look at this idiot. But it's not enough to completely think, like, it's not enough to change the way that you perceive me, because the two aren't related in that way. Like, that's not me losing 16-0 doesn't make me a bad person.
No.
It doesn't make me evil.
So, what have you got planned now that you've hung up your mouse? You're not going to play, and I'm presuming yours is going to be a real retirement. I've seen a lot of esports retirements, and it's like people just go away for a month, and then they realize they haven't got anything to fill their empty lives with, and they just come crawling back to fucking good old esports and pretend like I didn't just retire last month. But yours is legit, right?
Yeah, no, mine is I won't be playing Counter-Strike professionally. I don't know what level of if a team came to me and offered me a coaching role, and it was like a fitting, like it was a position where I felt like I could contribute and it would be a good fit, and there's all those things, that would be something I consider. But I definitely won't be in the capacity of being a player on a team. Like I won't be in the server shooting people in the head. I would like to get into like and the analyst side of things if that's something which is possible for me. The last week I've been receiving like emails and messages from people within the community, offering different things, or at least talking to me about different possibilities for the future. Mm-hmm. Some of those people I haven't heard back from, unfortunately. I know things take time. It's only been a week, but I definitely want to stay in Counter-Strike. And if I can't stay in Counter-Strike, I definitely want to stay in esports, because it's an industry which excites me. Like, I think it's got obviously a very bright future, and it's something which I feel I can positively be a part of. I'm not just in it to take some money and run. If I was in it for the money, I wouldn't have cut my wage and earned less money for the last 12 months being a pro player. I would have just kept digging holes being a plumber. But no, I wouldn't mind doing some analysis at some point. Like, I think that's something which I don't know. This is a question that I suppose I could ask you in a way.
Go for it. What's up?
Do you think there's still room for more people in that position? Yeah. Cause for me, it feels like it's getting,
we need more ex players, dude. Like, this is the thing, like how a desk should be structured. You should have like, you know, a host who just directs the traffic. So that'd be me. You have your fucking outspoken, opinionated firebrand, so that's Thorin, or me, if I'm doing that and I'm not hosting. And yeah, I guess, you know, Lurpis, fucking God hate me for fucking mentioning him, because that guy just shouldn't be fucking relevant, but he just clings on. He's like the fucking cockroaches after the nukes have gone off. I've never seen anybody do so much to, like, try and negatively impact on a fucking scene and yet still have the audacity to take a paycheck from it. Never fucking seen him, but people seem to like him, so whatever. Then you've got, you know, somebody like Moses, who's a bit more buttoned down. He's very kind of analytical, theoretical. You know, Dust could be someone like that as well. But what we're really crying out for, in my opinion, is ex-pros. Because there's a pro perspective that you've got to have on a fucking broadcast, I think. And you know, like, okay, something technical. Like, there's a reason why when we do these broadcasts, Gianco's the fucking weatherman and he's doing his bit. There's a reason we do it that way, is because he's an ex-fucking pro. You know, I honestly think if you were to give Thorin a fucking map or somebody else and say, like, explain how this tactic worked, of course they could do it. Moses has done it for us on E-League. But it's just more authoritative coming out of a player's mouth. And so there's definitely room. Like, people I think are criminally underused. Like, I thought Maniac was fucking great. I thought he was a great analyst. Now, he still wants to fucking play for whatever reason. I don't know why. I don't know. If I was him, I don't know why I would. Although the way Envious are going, maybe he might get the call at this rate. But
oh, fuck.
Pretty rough, right? Sorry.
Jesus.
I just speak my mind these days. I'm like granddad in his fucking chair. You know? just a bunch of nonsense, but fuck it, I've earned the right to say it. So no, but I mean, like, he's got like a degree in fucking psychology, super intelligent, immaculately turned out, very articulate. One of the because obviously he's Swiss as well, so he's multilingual, and he articulates himself incredibly well, and I think he's been brilliant when he's done desks. Right, but we hardly see him. Mm. It's a fucking goddamn crime, you know. And there's some other guys, you know. But like when I brought Mo to the table, it wasn't really about, you know, having high level detailed analysis, because I knew we weren't going to get the time to do that. We needed somebody who had the balls to articulate big opinions. Because obviously Thorin wasn't there at this time as well, so I didn't want the desk to be a little bit flat. Somebody who's been in the situation, so they can talk about, you know, mentality, mindset, can talk about AWPing, for example, which is what he did his entire career, and why picking this shot is good, this shot's bad, why standing in that position is good and is bad. Because they're all the things that have to come out the voice of a pro. I can't say it because people go, well, what the fuck do you know? You know? So there's definitely room, dude. And like I say, I always thought you know, out of all of the players I've seen, I've rarely seen people like handle an interview as well as you. Very personable. Again, immaculately turned out. It's always nice when a player isn't just some fat, hideous chud, you know? Oh, like, it helps.
Basement dwelling.
Yeah, you know, because like, hey, there's some out there who probably do have wonderful thoughts. But obviously, when we get into TV, image is a thing. Like, you know, I've been told I stand to lose like a good 20 pounds or whatever. I'm trying. I've got my gym membership. You know, yeah, you gotta think about this stuff. Perception's important. So, you know, I think you've got all the attributes, honestly. You know, I have no idea how you would do in terms of how well it would received it would be, what style you would try. These are all things that you would need to do a few events yourself anyway to find out. But, you know, I remember doing a desk with Sean Gares. Another great example. And I actually thought me and him had, you know, real good chemistry back and forth. He was great to work with. He's a natural at that kind of thing. So I could see you just as, you know, just going into that at the same level. And like I say, I think we need more pros doing the events.
You know, I was going to say, Sean, when he did the casting and stuff and he was on the desk, he was really good at it. Mm. And I think like nothing as well. Like there's a guy who have got good
personalities. Yeah, I talked to Jordan at E-League as well. And got his card and everything, and you know, he says
he's got
like,
a business card.
Yeah. Well,
Jesus Christ, what have I been doing with my life?
Yeah, you know, it's fucking. This is you're in that business now, dude. You're available.
I don't own a suit.
Well, you're gonna have to change that as well. What do you wear at funerals?
I've never been to a funeral. Nobody close to me has ever died.
No fucking way.
It's crazy.
You're like what, 27, 28?
Yeah, I'm without loss. Like
holy shit.
It's weird. My world's going to come crashing down eventually, but so far, yeah, no, I'm
fine. I know. It's like such a bleak, oh, I can't wait for my first funeral. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah, like, that's crazy. So you don't own a suit even?
No suit.
Well, you're going to have to change that. So my advice to you would be definitely get yourself a couple of suits, get yourself a bunch of ties, and just wait for the call. Just wait. It'll
sit
happen.
Sit by the phone.
Yeah, I mean, here's the big question, though. Where would you live while you were doing this? Because it's, you know, the one thing that's going to fuck you up is, oh, what, I got to fly that guy from Australia? Like, that's like going to double your fee, effectively.
Yeah. I've put a bit of thought into that. It depends on, like, I suppose, what offers come my way. If, like, it turns out that I can do a lot of work as an analyst and, like, it's a regular thing, then fantastic. Like, I wouldn't have a problem relocating. It would just depend on like how frequent the work would be, because I don't know if I could sustain. I don't know how much money is getting thrown around to people like yourself. I'm assuming it's decent enough to move country. Like
my day rate at the by the time I got picked up by Turner was at about $1,000 a day.
Yeah.
So I mean, I don't know what an analyst would get compared to a desk host. You know, I imagine it depends, because you'd have to go a bit down the pecking order. So there's that, right? And there's the other problem, of course. You're doing it daily, right? So it's like it is a day rate. You fly out for like 4 days. You know, maybe you get like, I don't know, let's say, I don't know, you get $750 a day. And then you do it for 4 days, you take that money and you go back and, you know, you invoice your expenses and everything else. You know, that's the other thing, of course. The money don't turn up if you're lucky for 30 days. So because you have
it's
to
like
invoice.
It's like prize money though, right?
Yeah.
Prize money, we wait at least 90 days.
Yeah, I know.
At least 90 days. I don't even remember the event. It's like, oh, here's some money. Here you go.
That's a nice surprise.
Oh, thanks. If you don't have the money to pay it out when the event is happening or within a reasonable time after the event, what the fuck is happening?
Yeah. Like, it's dangerous, actually, because fucking Turner pay me every 2 weeks.
That's all right.
So it's just a big bump of, like, a few... Yeah, that's what I'm saying, though. It's like...
that's what you want.
My entire life has been modeled around king for a day, fool for a lifetime. Payday, fucking nuts. And then by the last week, it's like, you know... chip butty sandwiches and fucking, you know, waiting for the next
noodles.
Yeah, 2 minute noodles and waiting for the fucking money to go and waiting for the check to clear. Paying me every 2 weeks? Jesus.
Love it.
Never going to be poor. But yeah, so I mean, I think there'll be opportunities. What's happening in Australia right now? Are there going to be any events there? Is like anyone starting an Aussie league or anything?
So that we have ESL in Australia now. Started up an office and stuff, and they're currently running an Australia and New Zealand championship. I think they've called it ANZ championship. I think that's what it's called. Yeah. Anyway, the finals for that, I think, are in late July. So that's what's happening there, like event-wise for Australia. I know Immunity were like seeking out more Asian events, but I'm not actually too sure what's happening with the future of that team. You know, when Renegades needs a player, where do we look?
It's always so, done.
I don't know if they'll grab someone from Immunity or not, but you know the speculation's got to be ripe in there. Event-wise, though, yeah, the Cyber Game is still doing their thing. You know, they still run a online league with land finals. They do the best they can with, you know, not another excuse for Australia, but getting sponsors here is pretty damn hard, especially for
marketing budgets and, are pretty fucking small as well. You know,
so you know they're trying.
But it seems to me, though, that would be what I would do, right? If you threw a application into here I am advocating for the Evil Empire, right? The MTG Death Squad of DreamHack and ESL. But like, if they've got an office over there now, I'd throw in a fucking application to that. And then by extension, if there's ever any events, well, you're already there, like probably helping with sponsorships or whatever the fuck they need. So why wouldn't they use you on a broadcast, right? And then that might also open the door to get into other mainstream ESL events if you're good. Because they've done that with a bunch of guys. Who's that? Who's that other guy? Fuck, I should know his name. God, that's embarrassing. They got
Uber.
Yeah, that's the one.
Mitch.
Yeah, Mitch.
Yeah.
He's good. I like him. Yeah. So I like him so much. Can't remember the fucker's name.
That's right. You know he's Australian.
Yeah. That Aussie fucker. Yeah. He's really good. He was a bit of a diamond in the rough, you know? So.
Well, I think like he was one of the only guys who like persisted with it for a while. You know, there's people who have come and gone within the Australian like casting scene, and he kind of stuck with it for a while. So he stood out from the crowd. We got like the Peanut Gallery, which is like a bunch of guys from Queensland. They used to be players. They're doing a casting thing now. They're getting involved in like different games and stuff as well, and trying to branch out from there. It's a pretty rough landscape, though. I think like if you have the time and the money and the resources to do it already, like now, then fantastic, you can do it. But if you need money, it's not something which you can just be looking at.
And I'll tell you something, right? That I think this is an idea I always wanted to do, and it just never came to pass. Like back when me and Henry G were like a casting pair, we talked about doing this and we never got around to it. And then we talked about it again, and then I was just going to do it myself. And then I thought maybe me and Thorin could do it. Just never happened, right? But real casts. So what you do is like you just, I don't know, crack open a beer. You take a game that's just been on fucking stream, you know, being casted properly, you know, like, oh, what the hell's going on, Dan? You know, and all this, right?
Yeah.
But you cast it just down to earth, blue collar style.
I did that already.
Yeah, well, no, I heard, right?
I swore a bit more than I probably should have.
You've got to do it. Build your fucking YouTube channel up. Get like Top Gun or whatever out of fucking wherever the fuck he's hiding these days. Crack open a few drinks and just like go ham on people. Like, you know, call people like, what the fuck's he doing? That's so much. People would love to see that. And that would take off, right? And you know, not only would it sort of showcase your skill set, but it would build you up a YouTube channel and get, you know, help you get some presence that way. So if I was you, that's what I'd do. I just start making videos and shit. Is once a community latches onto something and they like it, they'll kind of just push you into the right places. That's how it worked for me. Like once I got recognized for like one thing, that was it. Like every time I was in the running for something else, the following would help push me the rest of the way, you know? So that's what I'd do. I'd like to see that.
Yeah, no, I've always been a person, well, when I first started doing this stuff, I was always like conscious of my brand, I guess. And like we'd always on the Vox thing, because it was so much more relaxed than like, you know, we were just posting stupid videos of just like just ourselves and stuff. And that was always really well received. People love to see like you're saying, the real content, like the real stuff. Yeah. So like that's definitely something I suppose I could pursue. It's just, I feel like this is real talk right now. Mm-hmm. Staying relevant is the hardest thing I think in this industry, right?
Yeah, of course. Like,
and like my internet dropped out because the phone rang. So if you think I can stream from where I am right now, you know, like it's not happening. So like I need to like obviously put things in motion to be able to stay relevant in the industry. Like hopefully, like, towards the end of September, I think. Late.
The old phone rings.
As if it happens just while he's saying that, mate.
This is staying in.
I was literally, that was going to be the last question. So you were saying about staying relevant and how hard it is, because you don't have good internet, for example. So
I just tilted when that happened. Like, yeah. they didn't even leave a message. They just hung out.
But I mean, you know, how are you planning to stay relevant then?
I don't know. I haven't, like, it's not that I haven't put thought into it, but I haven't put anything in like motion, so to speak. So, like, I have been contacted by different companies and stuff about doing gigs later, like a couple of months from now. But that's, you know, is that past the point of me being relevant? Like, that's what I don't know. So I'm hoping to get something sooner and try and do something a bit sooner. But if I can't, then I'm going to have to produce content on my own accord and try and, you know, try and give some people something to watch or a reason to remember the guy wearing thongs from Australia. So yeah, there hasn't been, like, basically as of today is when the new life starts for me, I guess. I'm gonna start focusing on all that kind of stuff and hopefully find some stuff. I think I retired too late to get a call up for the major, unfortunately. So
yeah, probably left that one a bit late, mate, unfortunately. Yeah. Plus as well, I think when it comes to majors, people, like, you know, there's an idea that you've got to put your bumps in to get one, you know, like everyone makes a big deal about, like, oh, it's my first major. And to be fair, Valve kind of look after you. They give you these special little pins.
I got a couple.
For doing a major. Yeah. So it's nice. But look, man, I obviously won't let your data get ravaged or whatever on your fucking phone. So I just want to say, obviously, it's always a pleasure to talk to you, brother. I'm sure you're going to be fine. I wouldn't worry too much about it. I'm sure you're going to get a call from lots of people. I'm sure if you do make content, the community will embrace it. What I usually find after I do something like this, like a lengthy interview, they always go, oh, he's all right. He's human. He's a three-dimensional person. It's almost as if...
Who would have thought?
Yeah, it's almost as if we're not just caricatures, you know? So I think this will be well-received, and I think people see you in a different light. But maybe not. Who knows? So anyway, of course, thanks for your time. And you take care of yourself, and hopefully don't go too crazy while the girlfriend's away for 6 weeks. It's a long time without, mate. So so anyway, to everyone who's watching the show, we've kind of got a rough idea of scheduling. We're going to be back doing this on the weekends when I'm not on broadcast. So hopefully there'll be another one coming out again. We'll release them roughly Sunday, Monday, as we do them, and we'll just play it by ear from there. So, of course, thanks for watching. Thanks to Spunj. Thanks to Sam. And we'll see you all on the next one. Take care.